All right, hey, open your Bibles to John 13. So a little background to know before we start the reading. Jesus is obviously, you know, hanging out with the disciples. They're reclining there, having the Last Supper, and Jesus knows he's about to be persecuted. He's about to be crucified the very next day. It's going to start. And he knows that. But he's reclining with the 12. He's talking to the 12, and this goes down. So let's read it. And it says, "Now before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew his hour had come to depart out of this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. During supper, the devil had already put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, that he had come from God, he was going back to God, rose from supper. He laid aside his garments and taking a towel and tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and wipe them with the towel that he had wrapped around him. It came to Simon Peter, who said to him, 'Lord, do you wash my feet?' Jesus answered him, 'What am I doing? What I am doing you do not understand now, but afterwards you will understand.' Peter said to him, 'You shall never wash my feet.' But Jesus answered him and said, 'If I were to not wash your feet, you have no share of me.' Simon Peter said to him, 'Lord, not wash my feet, but also my head, my hands.' Jesus said to him, 'The one who has paid does not need to be washed except for his feet. But it is completely clean, and you are clean, but not every one of you.' For he knew who was to betray him. That's why he said, 'Not all of you are clean.' When he had washed their feet and put his outer garments and resumed his place, he said to them, 'Do you not understand that I have done what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If I then, your teacher and Lord, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Truly, truly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them.'"
Verse 17 right there. Verse 17 said,
"Now that you know these things, you'll be blessed if you do them." Now you know these things, you'll be blessed if you do them. We don't always know or understand why things happen. And he said that back a little bit earlier in that passage. "Do you not understand what I'm doing for you?" But when you gain understanding of what God is trying to do for you, when you gain understanding of what Jesus is trying to say to you, catch what he closed it with. You are blessed if you do them. When we speak the word of God to you, things that you may have heard from different trips, things if you have served in any form or fashion at a camp or on a mission, if you have served in any form or fashion this summer, raise your hand. Raise your hand. I mean, own it. If you have, it's awesome, right? Praise God. So raise your hand. All right. How many of you did God speak to you in those things this summer at all? He didn't speak that to you so you could go, "Oh, that's so cool, thanks God." He spoke that to you so that you could do something with that truth. Because blessed are you if you do them. When he teaches you something, it's not for you to take in, "I'm so much smarter now." It's actually for you to gain wisdom, which is knowing how to use what you know. Knowing how to use what you know. He says, "Blessed are you if you do them." And what we're talking about tonight, what the team wanted to bring forward tonight, this isn't just something to go, "Oh, cool, we've heard about that before, that's awesome, blah, blah, blah." I hope that tonight you really take in that blessed are you if you do something about it. Any of us can talk church. Sometimes I think all of us have moments where we do that well. We know what God says. Yet why do we sometimes lie? Why do we sometimes gossip? Why do we sometimes treat people with disrespect? Why do we do things we know God says no, don't do? And Why don't we do what he says to go encourage one another, to go reach out, to go make disciples, to go wash feet? He taught us what to do. Blessed are we if we do them.
Gold. Gold is something that is
super valuable here. But as you read the word, you understand that God talks about gold being just pavement in heaven. Pavement. It's just street. It's just something that people walk on and don't even think about. That's how amazing heaven is. That's how holy heaven is. Jesus was praised. He was worshipped in heaven. And the fact that he came down here is just incredible as it is. If you read, and I encourage y'all, if y'all get the chance to open up to Isaiah 52 later, not now, but if you just read that, you see everything that Christ gave up just to come down here. He left all his beauty and all his majesty. He left the throne sitting right next to God for eternity. He left that just to come here and to save us. He knew he was the only way, so he comes here to save us. But the fact that he just drops to his knees and willingly serves his 12 is incredible, and that just blows my mind. When you think of washing of the feet, that is a peasant's job. That's what the peasants do. No one's supposed to do that. Only the slaves, only the filthiest people are supposed to do that. But Jesus willingly and humbly just drops to his knees and begins washing their feet without even question. He knew it needed to be done. So that's what I want you to understand. He left all this behind and then even just drops to the lowest of the low. He was all the way up here at the highest of the highs. He was at the holy of the holies. And he drops all the way down to the peasants, at the peasant level, and does what they do.
Think about this. How often do we lose perspective? How easy is it to lose perspective? He just told you where Jesus came from, right? John says in John chapter 1, John the Baptist says in John chapter 1, verses 26 and 27, that there's one who comes after him, that he's not even worthy to untie his sandal. Do you hear that? I'm not even worthy to unlace Jesus' sandal, like at all. I can't touch his sandal, no. I'm not worthy to do that for Jesus. And yet, what does Jesus do? He goes to their feet. And yet, how often do we put ourselves almost above? How often do we put ourselves almost above thinking, well, we deserve this, we deserve that? We deserve nothing. We deserve nothing. We have a Savior who came to serve us. Look at me, like for real. Hear that. Receive that. Take that in. There is no other truth that ought to make you get rid of any form or fashion of a self-serving mentality than that right there. We have a Savior who came to serve us. Who are we to expect anybody to serve us at this point? Do you follow that? Who are we to expect anybody to serve us? And yet we so often demand that people serve us. Why? When the Savior, that we're not even worthy to untie his shoe, is willing to serve you and me? When the Savior, think about your business, think about your sin. When the Savior, who's willing to take not just the penalty for your sin, but the penalty for my sin, he's going to take our sins together and take that burden on the cross himself, right? Now look around this room. Look around this room. He's going to take all of our business, all of our junk. Kind of makes you not have to judge anybody else, right? Hello? He's going to take all of our junk to the cross and take the weight of that penalty at one time for us. Can you imagine what that would feel like? Would you think with me for a second? Can you imagine what that would be like? That he takes all of our sin one time to the cross in the biggest, most ultimate act of service that you could possibly bring. He takes the deepest, dirty, our feet are the dirtiest, nastiest part of us. That's a true story, all right? But our sin is really the deepest, darkest, dirtiest parts of our lives. He takes that, just ours alone, right here, and dies for it at one time, takes the weight of that at one time. Can you imagine the weight of that? Now imagine doing it for billions and billions and billions of people. That's the Savior that we have, that chose to come from what Connor just said and get down before the disciples and wash their feet. Do you hear what he's doing? Do you hear what he's trying to say to them? What he's trying to give to them?
Now let's snap back to reality. How many of us complain? How many of us, when our parents tell us, hey, can you do this for me? How many of us are like, I don't want to do that? How many of us are like that? Let's be honest. Like, and that's just an easy job. Go make your bed. We don't even think of that as service, but middle schoolers, I know y'all just got off of camp, and Micah hammered y'all with this. From 1 Corinthians, 10:13, it says, everything you do, whether you eat or whether you drink, do it for the glory of God. Everything you do. He said eat and drink. Those are the simplest things you can possibly do here. And I hope each and every one of y'all can eat and drink. That's easy. And Paul says that and says, with that, do it for the glory of God. Everything you do, whether it's just the simplest thing, do it for the glory of God. And how many of us just complain about a lot of stuff that we have to do and throw it all aside? How many of us just nag through all this service? You know, even when we go on mission trips, how many of us nag? Oh, you know, I don't want to wake up that early, and I don't feel like worshiping right now. This is too early to worship right now. How many of us, when we walk out of these buildings, how many of us act like a totally different person? We are a totally different person. And when it comes to serve, I'll serve with the church all day, but when we walk outside these buildings, people are going to come do stuff for me. I don't have anyone. I don't do anything. People do stuff for me. How many of us have that attitude? You don't have to raise your hand. But just think about that. Reflect on that. How many of us are like that? How many of us, when we walk out of these buildings, we don't care as much about other people as we so thought? As we were so taught by Christ to care about people. We don't have compassion for people like Christ had for his disciples and for each and every one of us. How many of us are like that? How many of us, when we're going to go back to school, are going to drop everything that we learned and built up this summer and turn it away into a different lifestyle, the same lifestyle that we had last year, going into this summer saying that we were going to change from? How many of us are going to actually change? How many of us are going to make that change? And I'm going to be honest with y'all. You yourselves can't do it. I can't do it myself. I can't just wake up one day and say, hey, I'm going to be a different person. When I serve, I'm not going to complain. When I serve, I'm going to do it all out of love and compassion that Christ had for us. And I'm going to use that same love and compassion for all these other people. You can't do that by yourself. You yourself can't make yourself do that. That takes time in this. That takes time growing in this. Middle schoolers, high schoolers, at camp, wherever, we tell you all time after time, like, stay planted in this word for a reason. This is how you grow. This is how you get that love. This is how you get that compassion. Whatever you do, do it for the glory of God. Whether it's simple, whether it's difficult, whether it's something we don't want to do, whether it's for someone that we don't want to do it for. How many of us have people that we just don't like? And how many of us have people that just annoy us? I'm sure we all do. And the people that didn't raise their hands, I'm pretty sure you're lying to me. But let's be honest, there are people that just annoy us. Or there's people that pick on us that we just cannot stand. And if you don't, you're probably that person. Let's be honest. If you don't have someone that annoys you or picks on you, you're probably that person. Let's be honest. But listen, everything that we do, for everyone that we do it for the glory of God. And this is the prime example that Jesus is laying in front of us, that whatever we do, whether it's something we don't want to do or whether it's something we want to do. Whether it's something as simple as eating or drinking, or it's something as hard as coming from the holies of holies and dropping on the floor, on our knees, and start washing people's feet. We do it for the glory of God. And with that, it takes growth, and it takes time, and it takes time of building a relationship with Him. But how many of us are those people? I really want you to think about that. I really want you to challenge that. How many of us are those people that are going to act like a different person as soon as we walk outside these doors at 8 o'clock tonight? How many of those people that are going to be different at school when we walk out of here this summer? Everything that you do, whether you eat or whether you drink, do it for the glory of God.
Who modeled that better than Jesus? Who modeled that better than Jesus? Because look at who we washed the feet of. Think about that too. These disciples, these are people that walked with Jesus through all these circumstances, all right? They walked with Jesus. They saw miracles. They saw God do so many amazing things. They saw Him show love to people that straight up in the world's eyes did not deserve love. And they saw Him love them. They saw Him offer grace. They saw Him when the leper was there and the leper was needing healing. They saw Him go up to the leper, and He didn't just say, "You're healed," and then touch him. He went to the leper who was untouchable, who people didn't want to touch. They're unclean. "Get him away from me." And it would have been just as godly for Him to say, "I heal you," and then to touch him and make that physical contact. But what Jesus did is He touched him, showing him, "I'm not worried about what the world thinks. I'm going to touch you because that's what you need more than anything else. And by the way, you're healed." He touched him first. They saw that. They saw how Jesus responded to the Pharisees. They saw all these things. And what do? They go walking down the road, and James and John are sitting there barking about, "I'm going to be the greatest. You're going to be the greatest. I'm going to..." Fight over who's going to be the greatest. "Well, I'm sorry. Who thinks you're greater than Andrew? Back off, bud." But do you see the attitude? And how many times do we do that? "So-and-so's getting more attention than me." Well, do you deserve more than they get? Who are you? And how do you know they're really getting more attention? Just because that's what you see in that moment? Who brought the loaves and the fish to Jesus? Who brought the loaves? Did James bring the loaves and the fish to Jesus? Did John bring the loaves and the fish to Jesus? Did Peter? Yet who are the three disciples that are talked about most often? Peter, James, and John, right? It was Andrew who brought the little boy. Andrew, poor Andrew, is like always the quiet back seat, you know what I'm saying? He saw these disciples griping with one another, grumbling and complaining. Then he gets there on his last night before going to the cross. And he takes that peasant, lowest servant of the servant's job, to Peter, who he knows and testifies to, and then it's proven, is about to deny him 3 times. On his final night, Peter's going to deny him 3 times. And what does Jesus do, knowing that information? He washes his feet. How many of you would go wash somebody's feet that you know, when they're coming after you, the person that you just washed their feet is going to be like, "I don't know them, loser." How many of you would care to wash that set of feet? That's what Jesus shows us to do. Without grumbling and complaining, just do it. All these disciples bolted when Jesus is going through this process. And yet, He still washes their feet. And He even washes Judas's feet. The one who is more focused on himself, who turns Jesus over, He still washes his feet. And yet we pick and choose who we're going to wash the feet of, right? We're so busy grumbling and complaining. I wonder if one of the lessons Jesus was trying to teach, grab me on this, catch me on this, hear me on this. I wonder if one of the lessons Jesus was trying to teach right here is, I don't care what you think. I don't care what you feel about anybody and what you know about somebody, whether it's true or you just think it might become true. I don't care what you think. Instead of grumbling and complaining, why don't you serve them? Can you imagine the person that you, come on, how many have ever gossiped in this house? Come on. Can you imagine? How many of you ever grumbled or complained about somebody in this house? Hello. Can you imagine if instead of grumbling and complaining, you walked over to them and said, I'm going to wash your feet instead of grumbling and complaining about you. Do you want to know something, y'all? It's a whole lot harder to grumble and complain about somebody when you're washing the dirtiest part of them as an act of love. When you're serving them as an act of love, it's really hard to come against them. Do you hear that? Think about the next time you're about to open up your mouth and gossip about somebody, to grumble or complain. Think, ooh, I'm about to say something about you that's not so good about you. I'm going to shut my mouth and find a way to serve you instead. Jesus served them. How do you get greater love than that, y'all? How do you get greater love? And if that's the Savior we have that lives inside of us, how do we not do the same?
I want you to reflect on that. How can you get a greater love than that? I mean, Jesus knew. He knew each and every one of the disciples' hearts. He knew what was about to go down. He knew that Peter was going to deny him. He knew that Judas was going to betray him. And then later, in his sorrow, would go kill himself. He knew Thomas doubted every single thing that he did, despite however many miracles. And the Bible says that there have been more miracles that were even recorded. That despite all those miracles and just walking with Jesus daily, he still doubted. How many of us in here doubt? How many of us are like Thomas? Don't raise your hand, but how many of us are like Thomas and doubt? Despite all the stuff that we've been through, say, this summer, and we've learned this summer, and we've seen God move this summer, how many of us still later on go on to doubt? How many of us are like Judas and go out looking for our own personal gain? How many of us are willing to sell the Savior for 30 pieces of silver when Jesus is priceless? How many of us are like Peter and say, God, go ahead, wash all of me, wash all of me. And then later go on to doubt him and deny him. I mean, how many of us are like that? We're all, Jesus, do this. Jesus, perform a miracle in here. Come on, Jesus. Jesus, take over my life. My heart is yours. My heart is yours. And then we later go on, and with our lifestyles, we deny Jesus. How many of us are like that? But Jesus, knowing their heart, knowing what was about to go down, still dropped to his knees and washed their feet humbly and willingly. He wanted to do it. He did it out of love. That's the love, the genuine love and compassion that Jesus has for people. And that's the genuine love and compassion that I've been praying for this whole summer. I want to love like that. I don't know how Jesus could love like that. To be able to walk with people that could deny him and doubt every single thing that he's done with them. To walk with Pharisees that just mock him and make fun of him and plot to kill him. To walk with someone that cannot stand him and is only using him to sell him for his own personal gain. And to still love and have compassion for these people to the point of death on the cross and still be able to say, Father, forgive them, for they not know what they do. They don't know what they're doing. That love and that compassion for people is incredible, and that's what I've been praying for so long this summer for. But we look at the love and compassion that Jesus had. Do we have that same love and compassion? Do we search and seek for that same love and compassion longer than just the summer? But when we get into mid-October and early November, that awkward moment between camp and D-Now where it just seems to all fall apart in your life, Are you still looking and having that same love that Jesus had for the 12? Despite all that was going to go down, when we're walking in our schools and there's people that could care less about us, that mock us for our faith, are we still going to have that same love and compassion for them? Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. When we walk around around school, when we walk on the fields or in bands or whatever we do, are we doing everything for the glory of God with love and compassion and a servant's heart? Or are we just doing it for our own personal gain? Or are we taking all this stuff and just denying it and throwing it out the window so we can live our own lifestyle? And then we'll come over to church on Sundays and Wednesdays and put on a little show for everyone else? Jesus had genuine love and compassion for not only the 12, and not only the Pharisees who didn't even like him and care about him, but Jesus is a friend of sinners. And he cares about those sinners, and he has that genuine love and compassion for the sinners too. And each and every one of us in here are sinners. We all fall short. But Jesus has that same love and compassion for all of us. And how are we so willing to throw it all out the window? For what? For middle school? For high school? So we can be cool in high school? You know how many people talk about how cool they were in high school? The answer is zero. And if you are that one, then you're a loser for talking about how cool you were in high school. Alright? It's not about that. It's about living not for yourself. Because if you're living for yourself, I promise you're going to find nothing. Nothing. I've been reading the book of Ecclesiastes. There's nothing in this life that satisfies but God. So really ask yourselves those questions. Who are you serving? Are you serving God in that awkward time period between D-Now and camp? Do you still have that same love and compassion? Do you still pray the same prayers that you've been so praying that God will reign in your life at camp and at D-Now? Do you have that same heart and that same desire and want for Christ at camp and D-Now as you do and in October and November and December or whenever? Everywhere you go and everything you do, do you still have that same servant heart and compassion, willing to do anything, to lay down just a couple seconds or a couple hours or a couple days or a lifetime for someone?
Or do you start picking and choosing your servant? Do you switch and go back to, because there's some of y'all are willing to serve. I mean, if you didn't go on certain missions, I'm sure you were willing to serve and do whatever. But do we go back, picking and choosing? When we were in Seattle, there was a little boy named Petter, six-year-old kid, cute as all get out, all right? But on night two, he shows up. His parents leave him right there at the gate of the school, and he just starts to just lose it. And the parents are like, you can tell, like, well, we want to walk away because we're going to go on a date. Brother needs to stay here for sports camp. And I see this happen, so I swoop over there, and I grab, hey, buddy, let's go get a hot dog, something to eat, come on, you know? And I had to go outside. I'm like, guess who hates hot dogs? It's a true story. And these were like the worst of the worst kind of hot dogs. But, you know, it was what it was. So I'm like, we're going to be excited about hot dogs. These are going to be the best hot dogs ever. Come on, let's go eat it, you know? And I take him to it, and we get over there, and he finally stops crying, and he's like, okay. He goes, I get the hot dog warm, this one, this one, yeah. You can put ketchup on it. Thank you that I can put ketchup on your hot dog. So I put ketchup on it, we go sit, and we just sit down and just have a cute little conversation, kind of, because really, I mean, most of you are close to the age, but seriously. So we're sitting there talking, and he takes probably two bites of the hot dog, and he looks at me and goes, okay, I'm through now. And hands it back to me like, you may now throw it away. Thank you that I may throw it away now. Thank you so much. Here, let me grab that. So I went and threw it away, came back out. The next night when he shows up, he walks in, comes right out. I was over there talking to Chris about the hot dogs for a second. It was just all starting all up. And he walks in and he walks right up to where I was. And he just looks at me like, oh. It's like, you ready for your hot dog?
Yes.
So like, well, here you go. And he's like, I'm like, Chris, I'll see you, buddy. Apparently I need to go now. But like, you may put ketchup on you. Okay, I'll do that. And we go. And I say that to say this. This is a 6-year-old boy telling me what I'm allowed to do to serve him. And I did it with a smile, and I absolutely loved it. And there are people in our lives, and some even wear the name of a Christ follower, that don't look as cute because they're not six, going, "You can do this for me, thanks." But what makes the difference between Petter and that obnoxious one? Would I serve them if they were him? Yeah. Well, then why would I not still serve them now? Why would I not still serve them now? We get this perception of who we're going to serve, when we're going to serve, and how we're going to serve. It's kind of like on Wednesday nights when we've had food up here, right? And there's trash left everywhere, right? And we're like, I ain't got to pick up all that trash. I picked up my own trash. Picking up your own trash is your duty, not you serving. Do you catch that? Taking care of your business is your duty. You picking up trash for somebody else that was too lazy to do their own duty, you're giving them grace. You're not saying, "Look at me," or, "Hey, get over here, fix your stuff." You're just going over there and picking it up and throwing it away. That's serving. And you know what? No one may ever know that you did that. You know that? No one may ever know that you picked up all the trash. We, leaders, may never know that you picked up all the trash. So we may not even go, "Remy, thanks for picking up all the trash." Because we may not know. But did you do it for us, or did you wash the feet because Jesus said to wash the feet? You don't pick and choose, y'all. And sometimes that's so hard. Do you know that? That's for all of us. Do you know there's times I've backed away from people in my life? Because I get tired of listening to people think that I think certain things about certain people. So I back away so they won't be able to talk about that anymore. And what happens? I get people going, "Hey, why are you not talking to me right now?" And I can never explain to them why. And that's wrong of me to do that. But because what happens is, in case this, I almost quit serving certain people because somebody else is telling me, "I don't want you to serve them." And God used some things this summer to give me a little bit of a wake-up call and remind me, are you serving Jesus, washing feet for Jesus, or are you letting other people tell you how to serve and when to serve and why to serve and who to serve? You guys, that's a hard lesson, but at the same time, I want y'all all to hear this. That's also an amazing lesson. But I want you to grab this. Jesus lets you take the rag in your hand. Jesus wants you to take it in your hand. He wants you to. He wants you to go serve. In his name, even. Do you hear that, Trayvon? He wants you to represent him. You. For real, come on. Yeah, you. How awesome are you? He wants you to represent him. How sweet is that, right? Ariana, he wants you to serve in his name. Don't serve for yourself, because there ain't nothing there. Serve for him. Because that's when lives can change, y'all. That's when lives can change. And it's hard. And I don't care how old you are. See, adults, there are a lot of adults that think, and this is a true story, a lot of adults think kids ought to serve them. Kids are beneath them. But see, there's a lot of kids who think, a lot of teenagers who think, we're just you. You need to serve me. You follow? So if that's it, we're all thinking the same thing, who's going to serve who, right? Right? At what point are we going to all go, "Jesus, I don't care what the world thinks or what the world does. I want to be able to take that time to stop and to get on my knees and, yeah, grab Connor's foot, which has been in a shoe without socks all day." Right? Let's be real. Keep it real, y'all. How many of y'all want somebody's foot up in your face, right? and take it and just wash it. But see, part of that service, you guys, some of you guys have no idea. You can't even understand what's taking place in this moment right now. Some of you can't get it because you may be focused on, ooh, am I going to get my foot washed? Am I going to get this? Am I going to get that? You can't get what serving somebody is really like because you miss it, because you're thinking about somewhere else, something else. Serving is not easy. For reasons some of you may have no clue, there's a couple that do. Sitting right here watching Connor speak in this moment, not the easiest thing to do. What a blessing to do, that's for sure. But when you serve and wash a foot, you don't just serve and get, okay, it's done now. You pray. Because you're doing it in His name, right? Right? So because like I'm doing His right now, it doesn't matter of this. While I'm washing His feet. While I'm doing it. Pray with me, guys. Pray with me. God, I thank You that I'm even allowed to serve Connor. And I pray, Father, that You would take him where You want him to go. Father, You would use this for Your purposes, God, and Your purposes alone. You let it be. Staff, y'all will come up here actually real quick, staff. That's all five of you. That's all five of you. Chris, that's you. And adults, if you come here, please, for real. If the non-college adults, like above college age adults, would come here. I want you guys to think about something here. It would help if you actually took your shoes off for a second, please. Remember we teach you, remember what Jesus said in John 13, 17? Blessed are you if you do them. These things, if you get it, blessed are you if you do it. These adults give of their lives. These staff give of their lives to serve you. I promise you, there's no real deep financial gain that comes out of this. That's a true story. The money is not worth it. And the volunteers, they don't get paid for it. But they serve because they want to serve. They want to bless you. So as we wash their feet, we're not even praying out loud for y'all to hear. We will be praying over them each one while we're doing it. But would you be praying for them? Look who's up there. Pick some and start praying for them.
If y'all want, come around. Come take a knee around. You're welcome.
Just touch you. Mm-hmm.
Grads and upperclassmen go over here. These college students. That the college students that serve you guys so often and so well. Giving of extra time, God. These upperclassmen who have already been making commitments of things they're going to do for you this year. To encourage you, to breathe life into you, to be there for you. And guess what? Not any one of them is perfect, but they desire to make a difference. And for the ones that aren't sure about the difference maybe they're going to make, because they're still trying to figure out where they're going, you pray for them. Here's one thing, though, for everybody that I want everybody to see at this point. It was a little bit different with the adults. I want to go back to a truth from the scripture. Do you remember when Jesus went to Peter and he's like, "You're going to wash me?" Jesus was like, "Yeah." Peter goes, "No, And Jesus said, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." Here's the deal. We didn't really give them a choice. We're giving you that free option to choose. Because in theory, we all had to choose. I know that they've chosen. I know the adults have chosen to step in and let Jesus serve them. That's why we know that they're walking with Christ. I know that so many of you are also. But I think we need to remember this daily, you guys. Daily. Are you willing to put your feet in and say, "Okay, Jesus, go ahead and wash. I want you to have a part with me, Jesus." Mind you, if you do let him, you're blessed if you go do likewise. He wants you to go wash. You guys, y'all are leaders. He wants you to go do likewise if you're going to choose to commit to letting him wash you. And part of that comes with just like as we've modeled. If you wash anybody's feet, or you're washing their feet, pray over them. All it's going to do is like this. You step into the water, Make sure you're knowing in your mind that you're committing when you do that, and then step out of the water and let whoever that is outside of the water take the towel to your feet and pray over you. Father, I pray that as we continue to move